Well, hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to another episode of The Unlocked Show. I'm your host, Tracy Wilson. And boy, you guys are in for a bit of a treat today. If you are somebody who is looking to, you know, really innovate or to try and find some form of opportunity within your current environment, you're wanting to start your own business and you're just like, I don't know what to do. Well, today's show is absolutely for you because my guest today is an absolute expert in being able to find, you know, often those ideas, those concepts and those opportunities that are actually just hidden in plain sight. They're right there, right in front of you, but sometimes you just can't see for looking. So my guest today, Bruno Pesek, all the way from Norway, is going to share with us how the heck do we do that. So we're going to delve a little bit deep. We're going to be talking about, you know, what opportunities do exist. But let me, before we kind of dive into all of that, let me tell you about Bruno, because, you know, today's show is going to be full of enthusiasm because he's an absolutely enthusiastic individual. His expertise and his quick wit are going to be sure to kind of have you guys at the edge of your seats. He's going to be both entertaining and educational, which is always a wonderful thing, right? And in today's episode, we're really going to focus on the practical and applicable advice that he's going to give, demystifying the worlds of innovation and strategy. And when you hear about all the different industries that Bruno's actually worked in, the likes of Toyota, DNV, DNB, Kongsberg Group, et cetera, you'll know that the expertise that he brings from that corporate experience that he's had over many, many years, but he's able to do something that a lot of people actually can't do, is take that corporate experience and actually distill it down to make it useful for those of us that, you know, might be starting out or just have small businesses. How do you actually take those concepts and ideas and make them applicable to, you know, just the small business? So that's exactly what we're going to be doing today. Like I mentioned, he has been involved in many, many innovations over the years. Some of them have been very, very successful. Some, you know, sometimes we fail, but he's managed to be able to take all of those things, be able to understand where the problems were, why particular projects failed, and he's now able to pinpoint them and actually share all of that with his listeners and with all of his clients these days so that they are able to navigate this process really, really simply. So welcome to the show, Bruno. It's fantastic to have you here, and I'm really looking forward to this conversation. I love innovation.
Tracy, so happy to be here. You made me blush, so thank you for that.
You're welcome. Well, it's great to have you here. Look, it's often, you know, on the show, because of time zones and stuff, it's often difficult to get people in your neck of the woods to be able to come on shows like this. So I'm, you know, extremely grateful that you've got up super early to be able to get in, get on the Unlock show and be able to share your expertise with everybody. So let's start here. Let's kind of go back a number of years, and maybe you could tell us a little bit about your background and how have you actually got to be where you are today, actually helping people to innovate in their businesses. How is that all come about?
Yeah. So that I don't go way too far. Let's start with university. So I went to university to study engineering. And while I was studying, I was applying for scholarships, and I was always obsessed with practical application. Engineering is practical in itself, but obviously when you go to university, you know, you're learning a lot of theory. And that is how I won a scholarship from Kongsberg Group, which is a Norwegian manufacturer that's present all over the world. They're also present in Australia, or were present in Australia at least a few years ago. And that is how I actually got to start working as an engineer in defense industry. And I worked on some very, very challenging projects. And one of them was those success/failures that actually triggered me to start inquiring deeper into innovation space. What basically happened is we had a customer that asked for what he believed was impossible. And we, as a team of young engineers, we were up to the challenge. We said, we're gonna give you that. You know, we're gonna pull no levers, you know, to reach that destination. So we had wild experiments. We went to the shop floor. We made a lot of prototypes. They were a total nightmare to manufacture, but we managed to make a product that was absolutely best in the market. It was actually so good, no customer believed us it was possible, and no one wanted to buy it. And to me, back then, it hurt my ego, but it also made me reflect. It was like, why is this happening? I mean, we made the amazing, the impossible. Why is no one buying it? And that is when I started going deeper into the world of innovation, realizing from my painful lesson that it's not just about product. It's not just about technical side, but it's also about marketing, how people talk about value, how people understand value, how people interact, how word starts to spread, how businesses actually work. And that is how I started going deeper and deeper into the business of, not business, into the world of innovation beyond just the product, but the whole business. And since I've been a curious kid ever since the beginning, sometimes it gets me into trouble, sometimes it helps me learn better. But, you know, from that moment, it just got crazy for me. I managed to travel the world, Australia included, doing businesses with both large businesses, and that is what I focus on. But I worked with thousands of entrepreneurs across the world as well, because the worlds of entrepreneurship and innovation are tightly interwoven. So I like to say that I had good luck of being at the right places at the right time. Of course, I was ready to exploit the opportunity, but I did have some luck in my life so far.
Well, you know, that may well have been the case. And some could say, hey, people are just lucky, or you've created that, right? Like, you know, it's, for most, it just doesn't fall out of the sky. You've actually had to do something to get to where you are today, which is kind of cool, because you've, you know, being that curious kid and wanting to know more about it. Well, how does that work? And why has that been the case? And I suppose having that failure early on, and this is one of the things I think a lot of, and I'm interested in your opinion here too, is, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs, it's like, oh, I'm scared of failure. I don't want to fail. When in fact, failure can actually be the biggest gift we can get, particularly if you get that early on. Because like you say, it kind of, you know, might have bruised your ego a little bit, but might have brought you back down to earth and also enabled you to really sit back and think, why did that not work? And had you not had that experience early on, then, you know, maybe the way that you look at things now might not have been shaped in the same, you know, in the same way, yeah. Which is.
So I completely agree. And failure is fascinating, especially because like all the things that become popular, like failure also became popular, especially in the startup and entrepreneurial ecosystem. And I think it got a little bit perverted. Like it isn't just about failure. First, we have to recognize that there are different types of failures. If someone dies because of your or someone's failure, it's not a good failure. We really don't want to go into that direction. Where failure becomes useful is if you're able to learn something from it. So what I would suggest to every entrepreneur is, first, you know, whatever idea you might have or you're thinking about something, think in terms of what's the worst that could happen. And then when you figure out what's the worst that could happen, figure out, are these things reversible or irreversible things? Like if I break my front door, I can fix it. If I break my legs, yes, they can heal, but it's not necessarily the type of failure I would like to have. So figure that out. If it's reversible failure, then it's much easier to commit and you will not feel it as dramatic, except maybe on the ego. Mm-hmm. But then the most important thing with failure and success is what we call reflection or critical reflection. And the model is very simple. So every listener or watcher can try it right now. Just take a piece of paper and try to remember an idea you had or a decision you made, and write down what did you think would happen. And then write down what actually happened. And then write down why do you think there's a difference. People do that for failures once they realize it's about reflection, but they rarely do that for successes, which is sometimes more important. So let's go back to school time. If you went to the exam and you thought you would get a bad grade, but you got the best grade, that is also a trigger for reflection. Why did you think you would get a 3, or I don't know, is it the letter system in Australia? Why did you think you'd get 3 or C, but you get A or 5? The same is in business. You thought your product wouldn't be a success, but look, the whole neighborhood is buying your service. Mm-hmm. Why? Why did you think it wouldn't succeed, and why is it succeeding? These reflections are something you should be doing regularly, and just have. Well, I don't have a notebook right next to me. It's in different room. Yeah, that's perfect.
A notebook.
Exactly. Always have a notebook. It doesn't have to be fancy. Forget about all the fancy IT systems, all the notebooking applications that have popped up in the last years that always come with a subscription. You just need plain old paper, one page to capture everything I just told you. If you keep doing that for every idea you have for a few years, even for a few months, you will become much, much better entrepreneur and much, much better as a person as well. Because what happens when you go back and you start going through your notes, through your pages, you will also have a conversation with yourself and you will realize, okay, these things, I'm a little bit blind on that side. So I need to pay extra care for this. To me, that's very helpful. I've been doing that for, well, now more than 10 years. I have like a stack of notebooks and I don't often go through them, but from time to time, you know, I will take them and I'll start skimming through them and I will see, oh, listen, this thing repeats again and again and again. I need to pay more attention. That is how I actually came to a lot of things that I share with others, because I say the position I take is, this is from my experience and from my practice. I share it with you. I don't share it as the ultimate truth, but something that I've seen again and again and again. So maybe you see it as well.
Yeah, you can see the patterns, absolutely, the patterns and the habits that you've formed over time. And like you say, you can then be more self-aware of, okay, when I see this again, I need to either avoid this or I need to do more of that, which is going to obviously expedite your growth and your pathway to success. One of the things that you know, I suppose I've got so many questions about this whole innovation piece because it's an exciting place to be in, right? So, and one of the things that, like I mentioned earlier, in this current environment, there are a lot of people that are leaving their corporate jobs. They're moving on to, you know, or they're looking for something else. They want to create their own business. They want to become their own boss. They want to be an entrepreneur. But they often are like, I'm not sure how to do that. What should I create? And in one of your pieces of literature, you talk about kind of the thought or an idea, right? So, and the difference between the two of those. And often, you know, people will have a thought of, oh, hey, I could create this. That would be kind of cool. So let's help everybody maybe see some, you know, in with what's gone on in the world of over the last couple of years with supply chains, you know, being disrupted and, you know, people being put out of work and all sorts of things going on. What are some of the opportunities that you see right now that maybe are hidden in plain sight?
Okay, so a lot to share, a lot to unpack. I'm now speaking from the position of a person that wants to start their own thing. So that is kind of where I'll be coming from. What's important, and you did touch upon that, you have to be aware that you have limited time and resources. Enthusiasm and drive is your prime thing, but you also have to take care of that. So don't blindly pursue anything that comes up. It is a bit paradoxical because at one moment or several moments, you will need to take a bit of a leap of faith assumption. Mm-hmm. But what is important is that before you do that, make sure it's aligned with your values. And here I will be a little bit contrarian. You will often hear like, follow your passion. I say, don't follow your passion, especially if you're alone, you have a family to take care of. You want to build a business that will start returning money as soon as possible. Mm-hmm. What that means is that you really shouldn't be getting into a business that you have that you know nothing about. So really capability is the prime thing. Good thing is today, because of the development of mankind as a whole, you have easy access to, you know, everything in the world. Really, it's a Google away, an internet search away, a book on something or an article on something. So it is possible to quickly get up to speed. But don't make a mistake of deciding, you know what, I'm good at cooking dinner for my family. And, you know, I always got compliments. So how about I open a diner or a restaurant? That's a horrible line of thought. And that's why you need a notebook for reflecting. because that skills don't translate to the business of cooking. And putting that aside, if you would go and start researching a bit about restaurant businesses, diners, etc., you would see that they have very high turnover rate. A lot of those businesses go quickly out of business. And this kind of thing, I'm just sharing a trivial example. This is the kind of questioning you should go with your idea. So let's take it step by step. So first thing that Tracy mentioned, idea versus thought. So thought is something that you have when you're showering, when you're cooking a dinner, and you remember a compliment. What you do with thoughts is you don't execute them. You don't implement them. You refine them. So when you are able to say, who is this for and what is it about, and you're able to write it on a piece of paper or say to your neighbor, now you're moving a little bit more into an idea space. I say this is important because if you go immediately from thought to execution, it's a world of pain. It's a world of suffering and a world of wasted opportunity, because you will be trying to implement something that you don't have a good grasp. What is it actually? And you will be trying to communicate with other people. You might be so enthusiastic. You go, you open a company, you call an accountant, you find a lawyer to help you with the legalese. That's all great, but way, 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 way too early. And you might end up in a dead end. You might figure out, oh, this isn't the business that I wanted to open. So make sure that you actually refine that thought into an idea. And then the easiest, fastest way to find an opportunity, save money, save time, save frustration, look for what works. Forget about being Tracy or Bruno that brought something unheard of to the world. You can do that as a next step. But as a first step, start looking for things that actually work. So let's say a trivial idea. So maybe I'm here misremembering my Australia experience, especially Queensland. But let's say you want to go to the Gold Coast or to some of the beaches, but you don't want to carry a wallet. So you have an idea, how about this bracelet with a chip and I could just pay? So let's say you had that, a shower thought. So then if I was starting to write it down, then the first thing would be to start looking, okay, how are people actually handling that right now? Are they carrying wallets? Are they paying with their phones? What's happening? So I would go to these beaches. I would try to observe what is happening, trying to figure out how are people satisfying that need right now. That doesn't cost me anything except my time and interacting with people. Of course, COVID restrictions in place, and we have to be aware of that. But that doesn't cost me anything, but people are afraid to do that, because people fear that someone might really shine light on their idea and figure out, hey, this isn't such a good idea. And the question is, what is a good idea? What I say, if you're a person starting business, the only people that have any say if your idea is good or bad is you and the people who this idea is for. So yes. If this bracelet with a chip is for beach goers, then the only people who will say that's a good or bad idea is me as the person trying to execute it, and people that go to the beach and want to pay at the beach. Those are the only two groups. Not my neighbor, not my brother, not
your friends, your mum, your grandma. Yeah, exactly. Who are all going to say, hey, it's fantastic or it's terrible. You're absolutely right, and that's one of the things that I find. You know, a lot of people, you know, we're rushed to want to try and get to the point of, I need to make some money and I need to make it now. Often forget to just stop for a moment and spend some time in that planning, that research and that development phase, you know, and asking yourself and doing that research based on those questions that you've just asked, you know, the market exploration. Is there actually a demand for this particular product? I mean, in your case, you're starting out, particularly if you're bootstrapping or you've got, you know, a limited amount of time and money, like you say, go and find something that's already working well, like go into that market. And potentially you could even be, you know, a reseller of something to get you started. So that's always a good place to start, particularly if you don't have a lot of money to get yourself up and running. And then you're talking about, you know, market validation and then that market auditioning, taking it to the market. And often, again, this is that place that people are like, I'm a bit frightened to do that because, like you say, that somebody might say, this is a terrible idea. That's awful. We don't like your product. You know, so we don't want to hear that negative feedback. But in fact, that's really positive, because what will it, you know, what does it do? Well, it helps you to go back, refine it, maybe ask yourself some more questions, or maybe get out of it completely. This is not a, this is a no-go zone. So do you want to talk any more about kind of those three phases in that, in that planning, that development, development phase, and any other things that you think people should consider in the planning part of the process?
So what I would suggest, again, speaking from the position of someone who decided to start their own small business. So we already said, start by looking at, after you had an idea, for something similar, and be inspired by it. And one thing that's also important, we mentioned failure early on. So what I suggest, the mindset when you're working with your ideas is, you don't want to prove yourself right, that this is a brilliant idea, but you're always looking for ways to prove that this idea isn't good. Because in the reversion, you know, if you go from the position, I need to be proven right, that's an impossible task. But proven wrong is much, much easier. So you can say, you know, if people don't positively react, if 30 people at the beach don't sign up for you know, for me calling them when this bracelet is available, that is a signal that something is wrong. It might be idea is bad, it might be the way I talk about the idea, who knows? But that is a good framing. Then, as Tracy mentioned, so once you go from that stage, you want to go more into the solution space. And here, when people think about solutions, it isn't just the product that you give to your customer, but you also need to think about your whole business. So this is where you start thinking more as a businessman, as a whole entrepreneur, is like, how will I actually do this? How will I deliver? But the better way to think is, again, instead of starting from how will I run my operations, is starting from the customer again. What is the first thing that the customer will experience? Is it your website? Is it a phone call? Is it someone on the street? Like, how will they hear about my product? These are all mundane questions that you must think about. And there are a lot of scary words thrown around. And here, it is better to reach out in your community to successful entrepreneurs and rather have a conversation with them than necessarily going, you know, looking for academics or enrolling a course, an MBA in entrepreneurship. Nothing against MBA in entrepreneurship, but you don't need 2 years to start a business. They will not teach you anything extra special there that you will need, that you cannot learn for yourself. And it's, I also caution you, when you start looking up things online, don't get paralyzed. So you find the guide, then you feel overwhelmed. Like, you know, the questions I'm sharing here right now are the things that you need. And the way you answer them, you can answer them in 1 day or in 1 year. Don't answer them in 1 year. Exactly. Start by getting answers fast and then update them. So, you know, in the beginning, the customers will find us on a website and we will be paying Facebook ads to get them from Facebook to our website. That's good enough in the beginning. You might be wrong, you might be right, but it's important to start and then adjust and then working from there. What is important is that never in this journey assume that you're done, because if you do that, you will miss opportunities to grow. Like, the simplest is sell the same thing to more of the same customers. But when you exhaust that opportunity, you're at a dead end. You want to be aware of other opportunities before that. And the easiest way to do that is both to speak to the existing and future customers continuously, having a conversation, figuring out how are they using your product. Please go ahead.
Yeah,
please.
And well, that's it. It just reminds me, as I was reading, obviously, a fair bit of your literature before we even jumped on the show, which is what I always do for any guest. And this concept that you speak of that is around, you know, an orphan idea, right? Mm-hmm. So, so let's elaborate on that, because you've sort of just touched on it about, you know, you're just starting with one concept and one idea, and this, the concept of, well, I'm just going to sell more and more and more of the same thing to the same customer. But again, the danger in that being that you're going to be outwitted, outsmart, you know, somebody else is going to come out out-innovated, somebody else will come out with a better, faster, newer product than you, and all of a sudden that market that you thought you had, you no longer have. You get to, you know, you dry up your ocean. So let's talk a little bit about that concept of of an orphan idea and how that sort of plays into this mix.
Yeah. Well, again, Tracy, you introduced so many interesting things. And I'll try to touch a little bit upon all of them.
Whichever bits you want.
No, but it's great. And thank you so much for it. And I think it's these small bits are often everything that we need as a listener or practitioner, whatever. Because in my experience, a lot of these insights are at the level of you hear them, comprehend them, and then it's like, now I just shouldn't do as I did before. And that is where it gets difficult. But it isn't really rocket science. So you heard, you know, thought versus idea. That's it. You just now need to put it in practice. You don't need to get the PhD in innovation. But that aside. So one small tidbit that I want to share, it's connected to what you shared about markets. What's the easiest, and why I said that the easiest is go for existing solutions, is the biggest cost and biggest risk for entrepreneurs that invest in their business is spending money on creating market that doesn't exist. If you're the first, that means that you must educate the customer. And that is a big, big risk. Because if you spend all your money and time educating the customer, and then a big player comes and just swoops up, outcompetes you, that's a big risk. That's why it's also good to start with something that already exists, because somebody else has educated the market on the need and the use of whatever product or idea you will be working on. And then you can actually focus on the value, not on educating the customer. Educating the customer is difficult, takes a lot of time, a lot of money, takes a lot of passion. That's why entrepreneurs often educate the market on specific product need, etc., because they lead by example. It's okay if you end up in that position, but just be aware of the risks. That aside, orphan ideas. Orphan ideas is basically a concept that, or misconception, that ideas get executed by themselves. Entrepreneurs are often, you know, oh, I should keep my idea close to heart. I shouldn't share it with everyone until the time is right. The problem is, if you do that, you deny yourself the opportunity of feedback. You might be successful or you might not, but successes are outliers in this case. So I think it was Rivian. So Rivian was 10 years stealth startup that now iPod to, and it's more valuable than General Motors and all the car manufacturers. Okay, not all of them, but you get the idea. Will that work for you? Probably not. And that's the reality. If you keep it hidden for such a long time, especially if it's a smaller thing, the only thing you will get is lack of feedback. And by the time you launch, lack of success. You don't need to worry in most cases that your idea is going to be stolen, because even if someone takes it, unless there's execution behind it and know-how, nothing will really happen. So that is this concept of orphan ideas. But also, if in your organization, so it's not just one idea. I often said, spend ideas, not money. So you find a bad idea, throw it away. Get another one, throw it away. Get another one, throw it away, instead of money. What's important is also for yourself. If you just find an idea in a book or something and don't make it yours, it's very difficult to execute on it, because especially in your business, you need to execute this idea. And let's say you start building a team. If you go and just hand over the idea to your team, if they don't take the ownership and accountability for it, that's also an orphan idea. So if you put people to it without creating this sense of, as I said, ownership, it will not get executed. It will not get implemented. And that's very important both entrepreneurship and innovation, because those journeys aren't always pleasant. They aren't always, you know, all fun and games. It can be difficult. It can be disheartening. And that's why it's important to have strong ownership of an idea for those dips. When the dip comes, the only thing that will save that dip is this relationship between you or the team and that idea. Is that making any sense?
Absolutely. It's that whole concept of, you know those entrepreneurs that, you talked about this early on, that, you know, you start out with a whole lot of enthusiasm and passion and a desire to be really successful. And it's those that really take ownership of it and consider whatever it is that they're doing almost like their baby. And they share that baby with their team, that that team wants to look after it and nurture it and grow it up as best they possibly can. And when you do that, that's when you've got, you know, more power behind that idea to keep the momentum going. Because like you say, if you can't get a team behind you, if you're a solopreneur, you know, and you've just got that inside of you to just keep going to make it work, there's going to come a time where you're going to want to bring on team members and you'll want to share with them the concept, the idea, and allow them to buy into that through the vision that you've created, so that they actually feel a sense of ownership and that same sense of passion and desire to also want to make that particular thing that you're creating be successful. So I think what you talk about is extremely important, and particularly that, you know, when you were speaking about a lot of entrepreneurs or just business owners in general, they come up with an idea and they think they've got to hold it really, really close to their chest and not telling anybody about it because they're frightened that somebody else will come along and they'll steal that idea. But like you say, the likelihood of that happening is pretty slim because other people, they might say, hey, that sounds like a really good idea. And here's an example. A number of years ago, I was over in the United States, and I was at an event, and I happened to be in a they call it a jacuzzi, we call it a spa pool, but anyway, we were in the hot tub, if you want to call it that, after this particular event. And my husband and I started chatting with a few other people in the pool at the time, and they were like, "Well, so you're here for the event too?" And we're like, "Yes." "Well, you know, what are you guys up to?" And one of the ideas, thoughts I had that had been turned into an idea because I'd mapped it all out and done a whole bunch of stuff with it, you know, but was kind of just still sitting on the fence. And I started telling these others about it. And they were like, "Oh my God, that is a really awesome idea. We totally need that here." Because at the time I was just thinking it was a very localized idea for my particular culture. And they were like, "Oh my God, no way. That is something we would utilize that over here." And they said, "And if you don't do it, man, we're going to take that idea and we're totally going to do that." Now, the interesting thing was, it has taken me, like, I dabbled in it, did a little bit of stuff with it. It was kind of like a passion project on the side. And it wasn't until, you know, a couple of years later that I actually put, you know, foot on the pedal and really brought the idea to fruition. But interestingly enough, even though the two people that were with me in that pool that day and said to my husband and I, "That's an awesome idea. And if you guys don't do it, we're going to grab it and we're going to take it and we're going to do something with it," they never have. You know, so lots of people may say to you, "That's a great idea. And boy, if you don't do it, we're going to take it." And a lot of people would be frightened and afraid of that and be put off by somebody saying that. And, you know, and want to kind of jump in really quickly. But the moral of that is most people don't do it. Even the ones that say, "Hey, I'm going to take that idea," probably won't, right? Because they don't have the same level of enthusiasm. They don't have the, like you mentioned, they don't have the knowledge, the expertise, all of that research that you've done prior to come up with that particular idea. They just don't have it. So being afraid, you really don't need to be, you know. And I'm a big fan of actually not sharing too much, but sharing enough with others that, again, enables you to get the feedback that you need, with the right audience being those that are, you know, potential customers. Which brings me to my next question, because right early on in the piece, we were talking about, you know, who you should share this information with. And we then also went into, you know, this whole market validation and the market audition. And you mentioned that the only people that you should really be interested in hearing their opinions or their feedback from are those people who are actually going to be customers, right? Meaning they're the people that are going to put their hand in their wallet, pull out their credit card or pull out some hard cash and actually hand it over to you and pay for the thing that that you've just spent, you know, a whole lot of time, sweat, tears and effort into creating. Which, and for a lot of people, they don't always see it that way. They'll think that, okay, I've got a customer base that I can go to. I'm going to ask them about it. They'll say yes. They'll take that as market validation that they've said yes, they would want it. But there's a very vast difference between somebody saying, yeah, that's a great idea, and yes, I would probably buy it, compared to someone saying that's an awesome idea and I absolutely love it and I need it in my life.
Yeah, and it is, people confuse future with the past. Whenever you're doing market validation or market research, call it whatever you want, and the questions I mentioned earlier in our conversation, if you re-listen, you will hear they're always past-oriented. Like, look at what people are doing. Look at what they have done. And the same is, so if you have an idea, existing, non-existing customers, whatever, don't go to people and ask them, would you like this? Or what do you think about this, etc. If I ask you, would you like to go to the gym? Would you like to live healthier, longer, etc.? Why would you ever say no? There's no reason to say no to anything, no matter how trivial it is. What's most important is, even with your existing customers, is looking what are they doing right now and what have they done. So instead of asking, would you like to go to the gym, you would ask, when is the last time you went to the gym? What do you do at the gym? How you know? Tell me about a day when you decide to go to the gym. How does that look like? So you're focusing through that questions on what they have done and the process they used to get that done. And those are the opportunities hidden in plain sight. People, if you repeat the same questions with multiple people and you start noticing patterns like, oh, they have trouble motivating themselves to get to the gym. If that is in every conversation or in a majority of conversations, bam, here's an opportunity for me.
And you're thinking, what can I do to actually solve that problem for them? Because clearly now what you've done is you've highlighted and the problem has actually bubbled to the surface. Because in that example that you've just explained, I mean, I read something somewhere that said most women, you know, try to lose weight each year at least 8 times. 8 times a year. And so when you, you know, when you're asking the sort of questions that you're asking, and then you follow that with, so, you know, what happened? Why did that not work? What prevented you from staying at the gym or, you know, continuing to go or whatever the case may be? That also provides you with some insight and some opportunity for creation or innovation into that particular market, because you've found a, as you say, you've found a problem. Now you can create something that actually solves the problem for that customer.
Absolutely. And what I also invite you is, don't stop at one. So have these conversations, as I said, continuously, and identify many, many pain problems. Because this will sound maybe horrible, but not all problems are worth solving. What I mean by that, not all problems are worth solving by you. You might discover a problem that is very important, but you don't have capabilities, skills, or interest to solve that problem. You don't need to feel bad about it. You're doing this because you want to make a successful business. So you just need to find few, hopefully expensive problems that you can be focusing on. And that's very common. As I told you, I work both with corporates, but with a lot of entrepreneurs as well. And sometimes we identify problems that are of sensitive nature, that are very important, but it's you know, it's just not within the entrepreneur's capability to solve that, or not even their interest. But that doesn't mean the problem isn't important. And as I said, it might sound a little bit cruel, but it is important for you as entrepreneur, because at the end of the day, you must build a successful business. Otherwise, you will be out on the street together with your family. So, you know,
that's absolutely, and you know, you're right. I mean, and there's plenty of opportunities out there, right, for you to come up with something that you have the capabilities to do, that you actually enjoy. And I think one of the things that you know, if you come at it from that angle of, hey, I could actually solve that problem. It's a big problem. I could make a lot of money. Yeah, you might make a lot of money, but you might send yourself, you know, batty, you know, in the process, you'd just be not happy, not enjoying life. And that's, in my opinion, it's not worth, you know, doing that.
And if I can, I would just add, it's not an admonition, it's more an invitation or a reminder, because you mentioned earlier, you mentioned solopreneurs or people that are starting alone as entrepreneurs. To all of you, please, 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 focus your time on the potential customer. Spend majority, 80% of your time with them, not building your website, building your business, figuring out your business card or things like that. Those are massive time sinks. And going to learn yourself to code the website because you cannot afford a professional web designer or someone else is a big waste of time. Instead, focus your time on really, really finding a good opportunity, understanding the customer, understanding existing solution, and then the shortest timeline to get from your idea to an offering that the customer will pay for. And then use that money to make a professional website, to make professional business cards or whatever you want. Earn money for those services instead of trying to, you know, buy the cheapest solution and teach yourself how to do, how to make images, how to do social media. You just need the basics and you need to reach the customer. And why I'm telling you this, if you're onto something, onto a good opportunity, a customer will suffer through less than ideal experience. They will tolerate your unpolished edges. Mm-hmm. But it's not the other way around. If you offer them polished turd, they might not buy it. Because it's still something bad at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. But if you offer something that's actually of value to them, even if it's a bit rough on the edges, they will give you the money. So that's a reminder to every solopreneur, because you're alone and there's so much work to be done. Make sure that every hour counts by focusing on the beginning of the business, the customer that will be paying.
Absolutely. And I couldn't agree with you more. You know, you've just got to get out there. You've got the thought, you've got the idea. Now just move. Start bringing in some customers, getting people to buy into your concept, your idea, turn them into a customer. And as you say, earn some money that you can create all the bells and whistles and all the fancy stuff a little bit later. That way you're able to get in fast, but you can also get out fast if the concept and the idea is not going to fly. Like, you know that early on in the piece. Otherwise, if you don't, you're likely to spend, and I've got my own web development company, but I'm just going to say to you, that's the advice that you've been given today by Bruno is the right advice, because you then can spend more money making a really fantastic website that actually is dialed in to your customers' problems, because you will learn that through the journey of bringing on those customers and getting really close, spending a lot of time and being very, very close to them. So I think those are important things that you've spoken about today. I also want to let everybody know there's a couple of things. So not only is Bruno, you know, been extremely successful in his own right, in his corporate career and then in entrepreneurship, but he is also one of the founders of a organization in Norway which helps people actually start up from a lean perspective. And it's called, I hope I've got this right, Bruno, but Norway's Lean Startup Circle. So you can actually join. Are people able to join that with you, Bruno, if they're starting out and they just want to get a little bit closer to, you know, you and some other entrepreneurs and maybe fly some, you know, ideas and concepts around? Is that a place that other people are able to join?
Well, Norwegian Lean Startup Circle is, as the name implies, it's primarily for people trying to start a business in Norway. But what I want to say is that Lean Startup Circle as a concept is present all over the world, including Australia. So I know that there is Yuri Timmermans runs a very big community in Queensland. I know that Melbourne, that's Victoria, right? Mm-hmm. They have a big community. In Sydney was also a big community. Now, I don't know for the rest of Australia, but I would invite anyone, as I said earlier, if you're about to start on a business journey, look for local communities. Those are the people that you want to be talking about, because they have local know-how. Advice from Silicon Valley startup might be useful. It might also be very damaging. I experienced that in Norwegian businesses that go and they're inspired by American businesses and they try to apply the same marketing and sales tactics and they completely go down under. Like in Scandinavia, it's not acceptable to have very aggressive marketing. It's not acceptable to be like American style hustler. That's respected in USA, but is not respected in Norway. It's a way to lose customers, for example. And the same might apply to Australia. And that's why I say, if you're starting a business in your well, local area. Start with people that have succeeded in your local area, because then you will get advice. Might not be as perfect as you would get from a consultant or a top head expert or something like that, but it will be very contextual. And that is sometimes more valuable than you know, having a top leader in, I don't know, entrepreneurship being your advisor, who will give valuable advice, but will also be at a bit generic level. And that sometimes, you know, to get what we said earlier, to get the fastest to money and value is all about contextual advice, local focus. Now, I went in all directions. Sorry, Tracy.
No, that's actually a really, really good point, because I think that's one of those questions you need to ask yourself, like, early on in that development and that planning phase is, so who is my customer, but also what market are they in? Is it a local market? Because if your market is in America, for example, well, for sure, you might go and get some advice from some, and you're based in Norway or you're based in Australia like me, and I'm selling to the American market. Well, you know, I may need to get some advice from an American who is on the ground, who understands the the buying psychology of the local people, because that is also very, very important. And I think the point that you are making is, like, you can't just take a concept or a marketing tactic or strategy from one particular country and necessarily drop it into another, because the market is may not be ready for that, may not respond to it in the same way, because it would come across, like, using your words, being the hustler and a bit more aggressive, which is not the sort of thing. If you took, say, something like that out of America and dropped it into the United Kingdom, well, that just doesn't fly with them. They don't like that type of, and Australia is pretty much the same. You know, it's coming at it from that real hustle, sell mentality. It just does not bode well here in Australia. You know, being a lot more down to earth, a lot more inclusive, works a treat here.
Absolutely. And I actually just remembered an example. It's actually an Australian startup developing, they're gamifying cycling routes. Mm-hmm. Obviously you have it on a phone, you load it up, so it's not just leading you a trail, but you know, you can also, if you hit that speed, you get some points. And fascinatingly, they decided to start with Tokyo out of all the places in the world. And what you just said, Tracy, then it doesn't matter what's your experience like in Australia. What matters is how people in Tokyo ride their bicycles, how people in Tokyo put phones on their bicycles, what they think about things and things like that. So once I highlighted that, then it was really easy for them, because, again, sometimes you need someone to hold that critical mirror, and then you go, oh, yeah, of course, that's obvious.
Yeah.
we really should do that. And then it really becomes as trivial. That was before the whole world went into lockdowns. You know, you just hop on a plane. I mean, you invest a bit money to hop on a plane, go to Tokyo for a week, things like that, and understand what are people doing. And then you can go back to your hometown and continue working. And it's really important. Context is king. So that is, again, a reminder to all the listeners and watchers, be aware of where's your business in.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, look, I know that we could continue this conversation on for hours, because innovation is such an interesting topic, to be talking about. And so I want to make sure that everybody knows how to find more of you, where they can go to. And I know that you've got a couple of things available for them, one of which is a really simple downloadable ebook, which really goes through some of these questions that I've been asking of Bruno today, but in a lot more detail. So I want to make sure that you guys are able to get a copy of that. And if you head on, you're going to see it come up on the screen in just a second. So if you head on over to www.pesec.no, so PESEC.no, have I got that correctly?
Absolutely.
You'll be able to go to Bruno's website and you'll be able to download that document. And of course, if you want to follow him, where's the best place on socials that our viewers and listeners can follow you, Bruno?
Well, I'm actually, the only social media I'm active on is LinkedIn. So feel free to connect there. I'm really open to everything. And as Tracy said, on the website, you will find a lot of things. What I decided early on is, you know, I want to share my experience. I'm sharing it primarily for myself to learn also how to share and communicate, mm-hmm. but also because of the others. And I share it not as the ultimate truth, but here is from my experience. This is what I've seen work. This is what I've seen don't work. If you can use it, I'm happy. If not, well, it's short enough right. that you didn't waste your time. Feel free to reach out at any moment, and also feel free to reach out to Tracy. She will know best. If you can't find anything about me, she will know best. And she can help you.
Thank you so much. Well, you guys all know where to find me, so you just head on over to tracymwilson.com. You can find a whole lot of downloadable documents there too. I even, in the show notes of today, I'll make sure that we've got, you know, Bruno's links, and also I've got a couple of documents that I think will be really useful in this conversation about innovation, which are 8 questions that I often go through and ask myself before I start, you know, working on any kind of project. So I think that will be useful for everybody that's listening today. But I say thank you so much, Bruno, for getting up super early and jumping on the Unlock Show today and sharing all of your, you know, your lessons, the things that you've learned, because, you know, it takes a really great person to be able to do that. A lot of people are afraid and scared to share, you know, your wins, your losses, and some of the things that, you know, maybe you would have done a little bit differently. So I love that. I love the fact that you do that so openly. So thank you very much for being a wonderful guest today. And, you know, you just never know. We might have you back again as a guest again sometime on the Unlock Show, and we can talk a little bit more about innovation and what's going on in your world at that time in the new year.
Would love to, and thank you for having me, Tracy.
You're very welcome. All right, everyone. Well, thanks very much for tuning in with us today. As you know, we are live every Wednesday here, Wednesday 10 a.m. Brisbane time. So I'll see you guys again next week with another episode of The Unlock Show with another amazing guest. So until then, have a fantastic week, and I'll see you guys again soon. Bye for now.